Yeah, let's go, let's do it, it's on, right.
Podcast 7.
Yeah.
Apologies. Apologies, yeah, first apologies.
It's been a while.
Being late. There's two reasons. Mm-hmm. One, we've been very busy. And two, we've kind of dragged it over a little bit because every time we were doing it, it was 3 weeks after a pay-per-view and 1 week before the next, so I don't think people really cared about our opinion because so much stuff had happened since then. So
not that you care about our opinion anyway.
But we kind of moved it so it's closer to a pay-per-view just finishing. Yeah. So we decided to do Money in the Bank and Battleground all in one podcast.
It makes sense for everybody involved.
Yes, so hopefully from now on we'll be doing it within 2 to 3 days of a pay-per-view. Because it's kind of one of the main focuses we talk about.
The wrestling thing, yeah. Which we'll get to.
Yes.
The first thing, I'm really quite shocked because I was thinking about this a minute ago. Has anyone died since?
The only one that I saw that died, and it was literally yesterday, is the voice of Postman Pat. That's it.
That don't count.
Yeah, exactly. I don't think. Well, I mean, you know, fair enough. It sucks that someone's died, but I never connected with Postman
Compared
Pat. I was a Thomas the Tank Engine man. You know?
But also, compared
if Ringo Starr dies, then I'll care.
Yeah, but compared to the caliber of celebrities that died at the start of the year, I think we can agree Postman Pat isn't exactly in the caliber of no. Prince.
When Jess dies, it'll be a travesty.
Oh, yeah, totally. Yeah, yeah. The voice of Jess. Right, I don't know where to start.
I'll tell you what we'll start with. Star Wars Celebration. That just happened in London. And then the Rogue One kind of trailer / special feature thing they did.
It's bad that... Okay, I don't know much about the celebration thing, because I didn't go.
But
it's bad that I haven't watched this Rogue One clip yet.
You've not watched it?
No, I've been busy.
Jesus Christ, even I've been busy, and I've managed to
watch a couple of the new stuff.
To be honest, it's good, and it shows a lot of stuff. And it's kind of like the Comic-Con movie they did for Force Awakens before the film came out. It's like that, but for Rogue One. But it didn't show anything new, as in I'm looking at it going, oh my god, that's that, or this is that. It's the same kind of bits from the trailer, shot differently, in different angles, and people filming it and talking about it and that kind of stuff. So there's a couple of little bits I can pick out, but nothing major that goes, oh god, you know what I mean?
I know they've got two new species of alien in it, which is cool, because they could have easily gone with, well, you know, it's a spin-off between 3 and 4, we'll stick to the aliens that people knew from both trilogies, but they've gone, nah, let's do something actually fresh in the Star Wars galaxy, which is risky but cool.
Yeah, speaking of fresh, they've actually announced as well, once they announced that Vader is 100%, he's definitely coming back, which we kind of knew anyway.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The new fresh thing is they've got rid of the title crawl for the spin-offs.
I don't know if I like that.
See, that's the thing. Title crawls, I think, are a staple of Star Wars, and as long as they stay in the main ones, the numbered ones, I'm happy. Yeah, I don't like the fact that it's been taken away, but as long as it's just the spin-offs, I can kind of let it go, I suppose. But it depends how they start it, because it's going to be weird not having the... It's going to be weird not having that and just going into something else.
I think I would have liked it better if the actual episode films always started with A Long Time Ago in a Galaxy Far, Far Away.
Yeah.
I would have been better off with none of that for the things, just Star Wars... This is Rogue One. Explain the premise, and then go. But I don't want it to be kind of like the opening credits to, like, you know, you're never going to get the Marvel comic thing that it does. I don't want to see something similar.
He's flapping his hand as if it's a comic book flipping.
I don't know. It's really going to... It needs to hit you.
I think it's going to be a simple thing. It will show the Lucasfilm sign, and then it will just fade into something and go down to a planet, and just go straight on with that.
Yeah.
So no title crawl. So as if the title crawl was literally just cut away, and that's it.
Yeah, but with that little music going... I'll have to check the Star Wars stuff.
I'm like that with that news at the minute. I don't know what to make it. It's going to be, we'll see what it's like when it happens.
Well, this is like 6 months down the line. I'm still like that with the Battlefront game.
I've not bought it.
I know, I'm hopefully getting it. I'll give it.
I think I might buy it when they release the Ultimate Edition for like £25 in CEX, then I might give it a go.
What gave me the interest was the Death Star add-on, which looked really cool.
Yeah, it did look cool.
A guy at work, it went the way I typically thought it would with him. He bought it, said, oh, it's amazing. He was playing it for like months on hand. And then, you know, a couple of months went by. I was like, you're still playing it? No, not so much now.
Yeah.
I was
like, yeah. It's like the amount of money you spend on it, especially with all the DLCs, like I said before. All the money you spend on it, in a few months, you're like,
Yeah, it's exactly what's happened to the Call of Duty series. Yeah. No one gives a shit anymore.
No.
So,
and maybe they would have given a shit if they'd given you the amount of stuff they gave you in, like, Battlefront 2, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if
yeah.
they give you all that kind of quality and amount of stuff and to get a full fucking game, is my point,
yeah.
then, yeah, people would be playing it for years.
I just wanted to get Battlefront 2 back out.
Yeah.
I don't care about the graphics.
And that's the thing. If that proves the mark of a game, if you think, well, I'd rather just play the one before. On the PlayStation 2, no less. Not even the
yeah.
PlayStation 3.
Well, mine was...
It's on the PS2.
Not Xbox One, but the first Xbox. I think me and Twig looked at the new... We saw the new trailer for Battlefront. Thought, wow, it's incredible.
Mm.
Heard about... I think the game had been released. We already heard about it, what we perceived as negatives. Like, you were? And then I think we actually said that day, like, right, when you go home, do you want to get your Xbox out and play Battlefront 2? Like, yeah. Obviously, we're the only two online that were playing it.
Yeah.
But I'm thinking, if we get more people to do this...
Yeah, I'd love to do this. This is why I'm hoping that eventually they'll make the crossover thing with Xbox and PlayStation, which they are on about doing,
yeah.
so that we can all do it together.
Yeah, they've
if
done
we
it
did Battlefront one. Together, that fuck me, that'd be amazing.
That's the only way it could save it at the minute.
Yeah.
To go, because
yeah,
it only didn't be one
if
game.
If you all had Battlefront and they did the cross thing over, it would make me get it.
Yeah, well, yeah, of course it would. Like, same with the another like money-making thing, if they do it with the Grand Theft Auto series. Because
yeah.
everybody plays that on both consoles anyway. You put in a
yeah.
multi-crossover to the networks, you're going to get so much more people.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, moving on.
Yeah, San Diego Comic-Con happened as well.
San Diego?
San Diego.
Oh, there we go. Right,
San Diego.
Okay.
San Diego. The whale's vagina.
The whale vagina Comic-Con happened. Right, okay.
Yeah, so loads of trailers came out.
Yeah, I
saw... First one was Wonder Woman.
Oh, yeah, I only saw that a couple of days ago, but very impressed.
Yeah, so was I. You know what I mean? Because Wonder Woman, for me... I never read any of the comics. I didn't read Wonder Woman
yeah,
comics. Because it's kind of like,
yeah.
when you're a kid, reading a Wonder Woman comic, it's like, definitely Amanda!
Well, yeah.
You know, it's like, back in those days, it would be. But, no, I knew the rough premise of it. I know, you know, some rough origins, but I didn't know too much about it. But watching that trailer just makes
yeah,
me
yeah.
go, this looks like it's going to be the Captain America First Avenger of the DC Universe.
Yeah,
it's World War
One.
You know what I mean? That kind of gritty feel to it, yet still got some fun to it. The action is great. The Wonder Woman character, like, when you see her in the action scene, she looks like a fucking badass. She's kicking ass.
If you look at, obviously, DC, Marvel stuff, Wonder Woman is the equivalent to Captain America in the thing. Even with just their so it's patriotism, is that the
yeah,
word?
Yeah, patriotism.
The shield.
Shield.
Time-traveling. Yeah,
exactly.
Even the feel of the film. So it is
yeah.
kind of like, the only difference is one's a bloke, one's a woman. So, yeah, I really think this is... DC's response to the Captain America.
Yeah. And I think at the moment they're doing the right thing.
Because yeah, yeah.
they're making it look about it. I mean, even using the Wonder Woman music they use from Dawn of Justice as the title.
Yeah.
Just keeping that music. Because that music is so cool.
Yeah,
it's so guitar kind of grungy.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's so cool. It makes her look so much cooler with that
music. Well, yeah. I mean, she was okay in Dawn of Justice. We won't go into...
I'm thinking about buying the Ultimate Edition because I've heard it's 30 minutes extra footage and it helps it
explain
improve
it,
as far as plot's concerned. So it doesn't make it great, but it makes it better.
I still to this day don't get Bruce's dream that he had.
What, the nightmare scene?
Yeah, when someone just...
that's Flash, isn't it?
What, was it?
Yeah.
Well, I know... Oh, actually, yeah, I know that now. But at the time, I was like, is that the ghost of Robin?
No,
what's going on?
No, it's Flash, because obviously Flash can sometimes run so fast he can burst a hole through time. So that's what he's doing. He's running so fast to burst a hole through time to warn Bruce that if you don't save Lois and Superman together as a unit, he'll turn bad and, you know, and he'll fuck us up.
Yeah.
So that's his point.
Right, okay, fair enough. Because that leads on to the Justice League trailer.
Yes.
Focus, but I did like the bit with Bruce and the Flash, but it kind of like, in a way, I was like, well, now we know what happens that entire scene. You've shown too much of that bit.
I suppose, but I still enjoyed it.
I enjoyed it, but I was like, maybe too much of that.
The film's still being done as well.
It's not finished,
which is the thing. It's not actually, it is a trailer, but it's what they've got so far.
Yeah, it's like, we're working on it.
Yeah, right, which is weird, because I didn't expect us to get a trailer at all.
No.
Really.
Well, it wouldn't surprise me if that's the only scene they've shot, then.
Yeah.
If it weren't with the Flash thing as well, it's shown, you know, a couple of bits that you expect to see in a trailer. It's kind of still going, trying to say to the audience, oh, yeah, Superman's still dead. It's like, we know he's not.
Yeah.
The fact that they didn't
show it's like, they even released an image.
Yeah, exactly. So we know he's alive.
It's like, he's alive.
And it's focused more, and I suppose rightly so, on how badass Aquaman looks.
Yeah, I mean, fuck me. Seriously, it's a couple of years ago, about 4 or 5 years ago, someone said, oh, we're doing an Aquaman movie, or we're putting Aquaman in Justice League. People go, well, he's going to be a joke. And you just look at Jason Momoa's version of it, fuck, he looks awesome. He even looks like he's going to give Batman a run for his money as far as badassery is concerned in this film.
The only one, even though they've nailed his look, the only one that I haven't really gave a shit about them in it is Cyborg.
I like the look.
But it almost seems like he might be a bit overlooked.
It really depends on how they portray him. At the moment, we don't know much about him, really. Yeah. But I'm happy with The Flash, Ezra Miller doing The Flash. I think, like you say, maybe they showed a bit too much of that scene, but I still enjoyed it.
Yeah.
The main kind of thing I really enjoyed is the fact that when he threw the Batarang and he went into full speed mode, he gave two looks. The first look was like, holy shit. He said, holy shit, is a thing. And he looked and went, you're fucking Batman. Yeah.
All
and that's
in
it.
The space,
in the space of that kind of speckin', it's like, I'm the Flash, you're Batman, and that's it. It's like, and I just thought that was really well done.
Yeah, usually, I mean, in the programme The Flash, he does obviously, at some point, you see it from his point of view, and it is like the whole world's in slow-mo to him. But this is more like, in the space of instant, he could even think that fast as well.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's not just speed that's it is speed that's his ability, but
he's got,
not just physically.
He's got
mental
increased
speed.
Metabolism in every way you could think.
Yeah, he can think faster than anyone on the planet as well. So,
I thought it was really cool. I mean, the suits as well, I'm quite impressed with, because obviously with the image, I'm quite impressed with the suits. I like them. I even found out as well, someone released it at Comic-Con, that all the armour bits that are on Flash's suit are bits from old NASA tech, so it won't burn up.
Oh, I see.
So I thought that, a little nugget like that, is clever. It's not like, he's just got a super suit, and then people can argue the point, well, why does it burn up? He's got NASA tech on it and everything that he's recovered, so that wouldn't burn up on re-entry, would it?
No.
When it's coming crashing to Earth. So, it wouldn't burn up because he's going fast.
In my opinion, I mean, I know you don't watch the Flash TV show.
No, I don't. I really need to.
It's really good.
Yeah, I know. It's the thing. I've seen some trailers and clips and stuff, and I really need to start fucking watching this.
Yeah.
It's the same with Green Arrow, but I just haven't done it.
I was just really... you'll probably fall in love with the guy, Barry Allen, in that, which is why it's so annoying me that they didn't pick him for the film, because he's the perfect
man. But they've already said that they're keeping TV and movies separate.
Yeah, I know.
Which is something I think Marvel should have done, really, but...
Maybe. I don't know.
Have you seen this new Superman that's going to be released with Supergirl?
The TV show.
Yeah, the TV show.
Well, Superman's
the picture they released.
Yeah.
The two of them together. Have you not seen it?
No, not
he
yet.
He looks awful. He looks like some kind of old 1940s man. He looks weird. It's like, that doesn't look like Superman to me. It looks like my dad's done some cosplay. It doesn't look like Superman.
Well, he's kind of been in it a couple of times in the first season, but he's always been either really in the distance or like a silhouette.
This is the first time you can actually see him properly. It's a picture they've released.
Yeah, but this... I kind of like the fact that they kept a mystery in the first season. I mean, the TV show of Supergirl itself wasn't the best show I've ever seen.
It's not great. I hope it's like that.
It's not great, but it's definitely not bad. Mm. It is very much, in a way, the way Clark should have struggled through getting through his normal life and trying to balance it. It almost gives it that Spider-Man kind of feel.
Right.
Like obviously, Peter Parker's trying to balance his normal life with his family and everything with the fact that he's a superhero. The only difference is that it seemed to me that off the first few episodes, Supergirl was telling everyone left, right and centre who she was. I was thinking, right, Superman, I think only Lois and his parents know.
Yeah.
He shouldn't
be telling everyone.
Yeah, so she's there like, oh, well, he's got to tell him he's my best friend, or... I love him, or whatever.
I love him this week.
Yeah, well, yeah.
I might love someone else next week.
One episode, she's like, can you get really, like, overconfident, so like, I can take this guy on, and she goes to fight this bad guy, and he's got, like, anti-kryptonite armour with, like, lava weapons and shit. And she's getting her ass kicked. And at one point, he's, like, over her doing all this weapon stuff. And, like, she's going to die. There's no way out of this. And then you hear this, like, sonic boom, and she's kind of in semi-conscious state, and from her point of view... just see Superman land in front of the guy, like, Superman's in it, what's going on? And then it goes to adverts, like it would. Yeah. And, you know, before through the adverts, and it goes, and it's her waking up, like, what happened? He gets asked, your cousin came to save you, so it's all cool. And like, oh, come on!
Hey, that sounds like a cool moment, but it also kind of wrecks the point of the story. It's like, yeah, isn't it's the like, point of the series
Supergirl's a
Supergirl
standalone.
Being cool? It's like, now it's like, no, she can't fucking do it without Superman. Yeah, that, it's that, like, that makes her shit.
Well, they, that was the kind of the and premise gets, of the storyline.
And that kind of also, it knocks towards women as well, I think. And I'm not much of a feminist kind of issue kind of thing, but it's kind of like, Supergirl should be the female equivalent of Superman, yet she can't even handle herself without it!
Well, they kind of tried to save themselves. The whole premise of that episode was, like, Supergirl are really annoyed there, because I think... What's his name? The photographer mate of Superman.
Jimmy Olsen?
Jimmy Olsen, yeah. He's a main character in it. And he's kind of having a romantic storyline with Supergirl. And it turned out Jimmy called Superman in. And she got really annoyed of, like, I can do this. I need to prove a point here. I'm not just the sidekick of Superman that is elsewhere and calls up on him when I really need him. I can do this.
Right.
But his argument was like, if I didn't, you would have died, kind of thing. But then later on in the series, like the main plot line, she saves him or she catches a bad guy that Superman couldn't. And there's a little bit, every now and then, she's talking to Clark through like an MSN kind of chat window.
Right.
So you never really
see... Do they have logos?
No, it's just a lot... But a part of me is thinking, if anybody hacked in now, yes, you're not going Superman, Supergirl, so to speak, but it's very obvious who you two are. It's like, it looks like this was a job for Supergirl. Thanks, Clark. You like, you would easily put two and two together if you just like looked over someone's shoulder like, oh, right.
The CIA are looking in on this.
Yeah, it's like, right, you're Supergirl, and then you've just told us that Clark Kent's Superman. Thank you very
well
much.
Well done.
Let's go. Not that you could stop them, but yeah, we should carry on, really.
Yeah, the Doctor Strange trailer from Comic-Con as well. Did you see that? It's the second
I probably will, but I wasn't exactly blown away with the first one.
It's much better.
Right.
It shows much more of their powers, it shows much more badassery as far as Doctor Strange is concerned. Even at one point, he swings his cape on, and it just kind of swings and lands perfectly in his shoulders, and he's just walking off like a badass. Oh, you're so cool!
That's pretty cool.
It was really cool, but it's going to be very like Inception as far as like special effects and CGI are concerned. It's going to be an absolute spectacle, I think.
Right.
You look at it, just the way that everything bends and twists as they use their powers. It's fucking insane.
Yeah.
You get a better look at, is it Mag Mikkelsen's character? The guy that was in Casino Royale, the chief.
Oh, yeah.
He's the main bad guy. And you get a better look at him and everything. That's pretty cool. Yeah, I really quite enjoyed the trailer. It's really kind of... It shows all the powers and all that kind of stuff and really what they can do. And I'm pretty confident that it's going to be an Infinity Stone. I think potentially the Time Stone is going to be all to do
right,
with this.
Okay.
But yeah, it's really, really quite good. I thought it was a really cool trailer and it showed me some awesome stuff. And one thing that made me really laugh as well, because it was quite a serious trailer. And obviously we know Marvel is quite fun. You know, yes. So they're serious, but they have their fun moments.
Slapstick bit.
They only have one fun moment in this and it was really quite funny. It's right at the very end. His little sidekick gives him a little piece of paper with his text on it, and he goes, what's this, my mantra? And he goes, no, it's a Wi-Fi password. We're not savages. And he's close. Yeah, yeah. It's like, even in this world, you still have to have a Wi-Fi password.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Not savages.
I thought that was quite funny.
Oh, I have to check
but
that
yeah,
out.
Yeah, honestly, check it out, man. It's a cool trailer. I think it'll win you round better than the last one.
Yeah.
You look at it and go, fuck, this is going to be a spectacle. You know,
yeah, I'll definitely incredible. Check it out. I mean, I've been... I did go to cinema quite recently to see a couple of things. I saw Independence Day.
Yes, I heard it was...
I enjoyed it, but
I've
definitely
seen some
that,
reviews.
Yeah, definitely that Holding the Pants of the first, because yeah. I think the time was right for the first one, obviously. This one is kind of like...
Will Smith is white hot at that point.
Yeah, and now it seems like, yeah, great to see a sequel, but you kind of left it too late.
Mm.
So Now You See Me 2, which is really good.
See, I haven't seen the first one yet. So.
Both brilliant films. It's one of those where you could easily go, yeah, it's about magicians, but it's not really going to be real magic because it's just special effects. But the way that they... It's not just like, oh, you take it as magic because that's part of the movie. They explain it. So it's almost like they explain the secrets of not... We're not just going to go, oh, he could do it because we've got CGI. It's he did it because of this way, and this is the reason why. And Daniel Radcliffe, I thought, was excellent.
I'm glad that he's kind of... Because it's always difficult to escape such a big role as Harry Potter. I'm glad that he's diverse to different things.
Very
to
good
try and push
guy.
Himself away from... Harry Potter, like,
yeah.
Especially when he did that that play and he stripped naked for it.
Yeah.
I thought that was a really good thing for him to do, really, because it kind of goes, right, well, he's not the little Harry Potter boy we know. He's like, he's an adult. He's really serious, and he's gone full in with his role. You know what I mean? Stuff like that makes me go, this guy's a good actor, and he has a lot of range, and you need to see him outside of this Harry Potter role.
He's definitely breaking the mould. I mean, he did The Woman in Black and The Horns, yes. I think was the other one.
Horns, yeah.
He's doing everything in his power to not become the next Macaulay Culkin.
Exactly. But and I think he's doing well.
He is doing well, but I think he must have to accept that to a degree, to the majority of the public, he will always be the kid that's
Harry
Potter.
Absolutely. I think you can't escape that. There's every single person has got a big role that they've filled at some point, like Terminator, that kind of stuff, that you never get out of. But as long as you keep yourself relevant, that's the main thing.
You have your main...
It's like Wolverine. Once he's done... Hugh Jackman will always be Wolverine to us, but he's still made able to put himself as a staple in other films.
Well, yeah.
But he's still relevant.
They always have their main, like, attractions, but so to speak. So, like, Robert Downey Jr.'s character...
Same.
His career was, young.
It was revived by Iron Man.
Yeah.
I'm not going to deny that, but once he's done with Iron Man, he can still remain relevant. He's still relevant now, especially with Sherlock Holmes and stuff
But even then, like, even all the movies he's done in the past... how old is he? He's...
45?
Is that it? So he must have done Iron Man when he was 40, roughly.
Was he 45, 46?
He's in his 40s.
Yeah, late 40s.
But he started in his 20s, did a lot of major films, like Sherlock Holmes and... Zodiac was one, and all these other stuff.
Kiss Kiss Bang Bang.
Yeah, that made him a relevant thing. And usually it's the roles like Harry Potter and Home Alone that you start with to make who you are. To go so late in his career, and now he's always going to be known as Iron Man, which can be a curse, but also a very positive thing.
As long as you don't let it be a curse, is the main thing.
Yeah, so good for Radcliffe.
Absolutely. The other San Diego Comic-Con stuff, I know you haven't watched any of the series yet, but they released this very small teaser trailer for The Defenders, which is obviously Daredevil, Iron Fist, Luke Cage and Jessica Jones all together. And they released a teaser for Daredevil Season 3 as well.
Oh, excellent.
Both very small. But the Daredevil one was pretty cool as well. It was a subway, and you can hear the train going by, the lights flickering and everything. There's like a sign.
Yeah.
It says... there's numbers saying 1, 2, 3, and there's lights all flickering and all this kind of stuff, and you can hear Daredevil beating the shit out of someone, like bang, 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 twack, and all that kind of stuff. And then the lights kind of flicker and go out, and then one light comes back on where the 3 is, and then the theme tone comes on, and that's it.
I see.
That's all it is. I thought that was very subtle. But it's good. And then the Defenders one was just as subtle. It was literally, it looked like, you know when you put so many posters up on the wall and you start ripping them off, there's loads of other posters underneath and news clippings and stuff. They started pulling that away and it revealed like letters, and eventually it dispelled Defend.
Yeah.
And it was just really cool, and then it just said, and then it just popped up with the logo saying Defenders coming 2017. Yeah. Very subtle, but God, it gets me pumped.
Yeah. I mean, I saw the trailer to Gotham Season 3 yesterday.
I've completely lost it now. I'm completely out of it.
It was weird because it showed a bit of what's going to happen in Season 3. It ended with a guy, I'm not even sure who he is. He's kind of got, almost looks like a masquerade ball mask over his eyes. So almost, it's sort of like Robin, but very like masquerade ball-esque. And I looked at him and thought, I don't recognise him as a villain. I'm guessing I'm meant to recognise him as a villain. And it's him and Alfred, like, fist to fist in the office, and they go lunge into a fight. And
it's things like that with prequel stuff that makes me just not care, because whenever they end something like that, end a trailer with that, it's just like, well, I'm not afraid because Alfred, I know he survives. He obviously survives. It doesn't give me any fear. That's the only problem with prequels, is that you know these certain people survive.
But yeah, I think some of it as well was... Well, I don't know, because they seem to be changing the storyline so much. Like, in Season 2, Nora Freeze is already dead.
Yeah, I remember you telling me.
Which I didn't really like.
Yeah, I thought it was a mistake.
But again, it's like, right, you're going with that. They've killed off Asriel straight off the bat, so you're never going to see Asriel Batman. But there are ways that he could, I suppose, come back.
Yeah, remember you telling me all that stuff about coming back and stuff.
Well, there isn't. Doctor Strange.
Hugo Strange.
He brought him back to life. Convinced him he was this character Asriel, so he's almost like, with the mental patients he's got, he's convinced them they're these supervillains. Like, there was a tease, like, he realised he could do it with Asriel, and he's talked to his assistant, like, we could do this with all the our major patients. And he's got books, like, because he got the Asriel character from, like, a religious book. And he's looking at all these books, and he had Alice in Wonderland. And read a line from the Mad Hatter, like, that's a good one. He's like, well, you know, he's going to create the Mad Hatter in this. So a part of me thinking, right, Asriel's dead. Is he eventually going to go back to his old ways, find another vessel, so to speak, and convince him he's Asriel to fight the Batman?
Yeah, could do.
But the start of the trailer opened with those bodies on the road that said Maniacs,
yeah,
and showing the Joker. I was thinking, right, is that a thing to
tease?
Say?
I would like to hope so, because...
Because, you know, that thing didn't happen. The first parts of the trailer were like almost flashbacks what happened in the previous two seasons.
Yeah.
Thinking to open with Maniacs and the Joker doing that whole "you ain't seen nothing yet" and the man in the lap is like, there's got to be a tip of the cap to go, he has to return.
Yeah.
Because there's no way he can be dead. He's got to fight the Batman.
I hope so. It'll bring me back round if they bring him back.
But yeah, that's what a lot of my friends were saying.
Also, things that happened a while back, gaming-related, E3 that happened, which mm-hmm. is basically like gaming Comic-Con.
Yeah.
They released that Crash Bandicoot's coming back.
I heard about
which
that.
Looks awesome. I've seen some of the artwork and that. It looks really cool. They released a trailer for that Spider-Man game.
Have you seen that?
Oh, dude, it looks epic. And right. It even looks like they've kind of adopted the Arkham fight style.
Oh, excellent.
Honestly, it looks great.
Yeah.
And they've also said that they're remastering Skyrim
for
the new generation, which I can't wait.
My mate's so happy about that.
I know, so I was like, yes! I'm so happy! And then the main thing that made me so happy was they've officially released a proper full trailer and shitloads of gameplay for The Legend of Zelda, the Wii U. They finally released it. Okay. They called it Breath of the Wild, apparently it's called.
Yeah.
And it basically looks like Skyrim for Legend of Zelda. It looks fucking huge.
Awesome.
Monstrous.
I know there's a huge demand for that brand of game. They tried to reboot Sonic, and I still think they are trying to, but it's a very difficult one to reboot.
it worked better on 2D platforms.
It's the same with Mario.
Yeah.
Mario Kart will always work, but other ones might not like
it. Mario 64.
Yeah.
Sunshine wasn't too bad.
But after the Sunshine, it started to get a bit stupid.
Yeah, the Galaxy ones, I was just like...
Yeah, and the same, the hope I got with Crash, as much as I love Crash Bandicoot, it's like, well, if you don't Crash, you've got to do Spyro.
Apparently, it's basically a revamp of the original ones.
Which I like, so I want them to do the same with Spyro the Dragon, because Spyro is absolutely
amazing. Yeah, I quite like Spyro as well.
But if they make him a more badass-looking dragon, like, okay, it was a kid's game, and
because Spyro's become Skylanders now, isn't it?
With I can't stand Skylanders.
It's shit, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's like... Spyro's just become irrelevant, isn't he?
Well, yeah,
as a character.
I've seen the gameplay, and it seems like you just wander around as these characters that you have to buy separately to put on a base thing. I'm like, how much money are you spending just to put a character on the game and fuck around, like burning houses down and shit? Like, it annoys me enough that you have to sometimes get good characters through DLC, but to actually have to physically go buy a toy and buy a base thing to upload it to do pretty much nothing. Bullshit.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I guess in the only other game, I don't think we spoke about, is WWE 2K17.
2K17, Brock Lesnar's on the front.
And Goldberg's
a player.
Yeah. The weird thing is, I know how disappointed everyone was that the teaser trailer of that Shaq ended up just being for the game and all that. But both really pump you up. Like, I liked the way they did the Goldberg thing. Like, it was almost revealed straight away with the way the cops were marching to Goldberg's music. So it's like... Yeah, and straight away I was like, I think that was going on. To blow up the doors and he's just standing in the smoke and then have the security, like, what's the word? Escort.
Yeah.
And then, not many people noticed, but I did straight off the bat, when he's in the back of the car and he looks out the window, in the reflection of the window, he's the sign saying Suplex City. I was like, right, is that a tease for the game, or are you planning something?
It's the same thing as when they did the trailer for the Brock Lesnar version of the game. They even mentioned, like, be like this person, be like that person, be like Goldberg. And I was like, are they trying to tease that Goldberg and Lesnar might be going for a rematch at Mania or something? Because they realised how shit that match was last time, because they were both leaving and hating the company. Are they trying to redeem themselves? Are they trying to put as much money behind Goldberg and Lesnar as possible and say, guys, come back, have an awesome match, redeem yourself from that shite of a match you had before,
the storyline would be great if that was the way they went. Because if I so hope they keep Paul Heyman. I really do.
Yeah.
And all they have to do is Heyman can go, have Lesnar tear him from the park, Goldberg come out, then the confrontation to make it look, and then a back off, but go, right, the seed's been planted. And then Heyman can explain on Lesnar's behalf, because, well, what was it, almost 13 years ago when they first bought, you know, pretty much what you said, like they didn't care and blah, 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 all that stuff, but Lesnar didn't see the challenge in Bill. Yes, he lost, but did he care? No. But Lesnar is now on such a wrecking ball machine that he can prove that he can tear Bill apart. He's much better, much more focused, and or it could just be as simple as Heyman and Lesnar keep saying no. No, no, and Goldberg can go...
Forces her hand.
Well, almost that, and go like, I beat you. He won at WrestleMania 20, even though it was crap.
Mm.
But he can go, I'm the only man you can't beat. Just keep poking him, yeah. Like, I beat you once, I can do it again. And the reason you ain't stepping back in this ring with me is you know you can't. And if you really want to make it what it should have been of these two tearing each other apart, have Austin as the referee again. Yeah. And then you'd get so much buzz around that.
So, should we move on into the wrestling
thing? I think that's the way it's going to go.
It's kind of going that
way. It's gone that way. So.
Right. Are we ready?
Oh, we're ready. I was kind of impressed that after 2 months almost we remembered
that. We remembered that perfectly.
Usually we
Well, we've got another song later. We'll probably fuck that up.
Yeah. So the main thing we've got to talk about is the Money in the Bank.
Money in the Bank we'll get through quickly because that's been a while. And then we'll get on to the ground and the draft.
Yeah.
And the best Raw and SmackDown we've had in ages this week.
Yes.
So but, yeah, Money in the Bank wise.
I'm trying to remember what the other matches were.
To be honest, I'm just so happy about what happened, really. I just think it was absolutely perfect for the main event. I think it was great. Having Reigns lose clean to Rollins makes him look awesome, and then getting cashed in on by Dean, which was just he's the quickest cash in history as well, which is awesome.
Yeah, he just beat Kane.
Yeah, he beat Kane.
Yeah.
And the nice little nugget, the fact that all three members of the Shield held the title in one night.
Yeah,
it was great.
What was also weird is I hate the fact that I spoiled that one thing for myself, which in essence spoiled two things, because then I knew who won the Money in the Bank ladder match and who walked out with the championship. But it was the first time in a while that we'd actually watched it together.
Yeah.
So I can't even remember what the other matches were. Oh, AJ Styles beat Cena.
AJ beat Cena with club helping.
Yeah, great match, but the club thing kind of left a bad taste in people's mouth.
Yeah.
The Money in the Bank ladder match was fantastic.
Yeah, that was a good
especially
one.
Especially Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens.
Oh, when he landed him on the edge of that ladder.
It's like, how's he not broke his back?
I know. I don't understand how he doesn't break his back. The amount of times he's been landed on it.
Yeah, this is how well these two work together. Yeah, they're absolutely excellent. I'm trying to remember what happened tag title-wise. I mean, obviously, it would have been the New Day against someone. Weren't the Wyatts?
I don't fucking remember, you know.
No, it's been so long ago. Well, not really that long ago. June-ish. So,
then we get Corbin and Ziggler again.
Yeah, I think I remember the card not looking great.
Sheamus and Apollo, I think we got as well, didn't we?
Yeah, that was a kind of roll-up victory as well.
Basically, yeah, I don't think made Apollo look strong, really. I think he should have a clean win.
Yes, I agree.
A roll up
that.
Doesn't make him look big.
No, it doesn't. I mean, I think we can obviously whoever Charlotte went against, she won because she was still women's champion when she left. Did Rusev win the US title like that? No, he didn't. He won the Extreme Rules. So whoever Rusev was against, he kept the belt. It only might have been the ladder match, all I know.
Who the fuck did he go against?
I don't know.
I can't remember.
And I don't think Miz was there.
Titus O'Neil.
Titus, that was it.
Titus.
Yeah, and Miz wasn't there because he was taking time off.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, obviously you had Seth versus Roman. Seth won. Dean came in. Cashed in. Dean Ambrose is our new WWE champion.
I thought it was brilliant. It's like he just didn't... It makes his character look even more awesome. And it is his character. It's like, I've got this. I'm not fucking around. Let's get this done. Let's cash this fucker in and get that belt off that cunt and on me.
But yeah,
you know what I mean?
He doesn't care if he does it cleanly or not. He could have been the very honourable man of like, I'll challenge you in advance or I'll come down the aisle to go almost do what Seth did and from behind and smash him in the head with the case and go, now, Dirty Deeds, job done. It's like, he will bend the rules if he needs to, because Dean just doesn't care.
Yeah.
That's his character.
And it's very Austin-like, and I think
yes.
they've got an Austin kind of character in him if they push him right.
Yeah, definitely.
So, yeah, I mean, onwards to
Battleground
that just happened a week ago.
It was okay.
It was good. I think it... Well, not that it says much. I mean, I've reviewed it, so it's up there. But I'll say what I said again. It's the best Battleground we've ever had, which isn't saying much, because all Battlegrounds are normally shit.
Yeah.
But this was good. I think it was a solid pay-per-view. There's only a couple of matches I was kind of like, meh, about.
Yeah.
Natalya and Becky, unfortunately, was the piss break match, which is a shame, because...
Yeah, my brother said it was good, Becky. But it, no one was really behind it.
I think the main reason is because it was straight after Sami Zayn and Owen.
Yeah.
And it's just, everyone was so deflated from the match, because it was the match of the night. They were absolutely fucking incredible. And then to have that straight after, it's kind of like, well, I need to rest after that, because that was insane.
I mean,
they got a standing ovation halfway through that
match.
Yeah,
that, I was about to say
that. That was just like, wow.
The only other time I've seen that was another Sami Zayn match, when he went against Cesaro at NXT.
Yes.
So, yeah. I mean, I'm not pissing on the parade. It was an excellent match, but I've seen better matches between the two. I think because, especially with my brother about, we get to see stuff they've had in previous companies.
Mm.
And there's one that I'll show you at some point where it was called Kevin Steen, which I think is his real name, versus a guy called El Generico, mask guy, which was Sami Zayn. And it was a last man standing match. And my God, it's one of the most brutal... It had everything. That hardcore, technical, high flying. It was just the story was excellent. So I'll show you that.
Thing with WWE's PG thing, it's restricted on what you can do. But
no, but still
within the confines, I think that match was incredible.
Yeah, the brain buster on the apron.
Yeah, when he just landed his shoulders. It was like, oh God, not his shoulder. And then seconds later, he suplexes Owens on the fucking apron.
Yeah, I mean, my brother thought, did he do it on purpose? I was like, I don't think he did that on purpose. I think it was a cock up. But I was really worried at some point. I was like, is he really hurt?
I'm just like. Bless Owens for trying to get to him as well.
Yeah.
You see him just kind of pop up and trying to make it to him. You know what I mean? I think just trying to... Having that ring presence. It's like, oh shit, he's fucked up. Get up, make it look as believable as possible and try not to get hurt.
Yeah, we say that the Battlegrounds are usually crap. Well, not crap, but there's only really one standout a match. But there's always been a standout moment for each of the Battleground pay-per-views. Like there was,
It's normally that's the only highlight, really.
Yeah.
The rest of it's kind of throwaway.
We got The Shield versus Cody Rhodes Goldust at one point. Excellent.
That was good.
Excellent.
And it was written good as well.
Yes,
as far as storyline's concerned, it's built up.
And had Dusty there and everything. Then I think a year later it was The Usos versus Harper and Rowan, which, if you don't remember, watch it. Absolutely amazing.
Yeah, well, I remember it.
And then, even though it weren't a great match, it was the moment where The Undertaker returned and screwed Lesnar out the belt.
Yes, I remember that.
So, yeah, it's kind of putting Battleground in its place of, like, this is going to be a pay-per-view that we won't be, like, super excited about, but we'll always be like, all right,
still
cool.
One to watch.
It's interesting.
I mean, the main event as well, I thought it was good. It really was a good main event. But I would have preferred it to go on a little bit longer.
Yeah.
You know, it's like the Dirty Deeds kind of came out of nowhere, and that was it. Ambrose is champ still. And I'm glad that they are, because, again, it gives SmackDown a proper chance now.
Yeah.
It's like they've got the title there, and that helps.
Yeah.
But I felt like I wanted a few more spots. You know, the final like 5 minutes when everybody's back and forth, spots here, spots there, everywhere, going mental. Then the Dirty Deeds, and then he wins. But it kind of felt like Reigns and Rollins were going at it, and then Dean just popped up, Dirty Deeds, done. And I felt like I just wanted a little bit more out of it.
The problems I thought about was it seemed very, and this is no one's fault, but obviously a very overhyped match because people had been looking forward to this for ages. They'd done it at the wrong pay-per-view. It should have been a WrestleMania-worthy kind of match.
Yeah, at the very least, SummerSlam.
Yeah, and the fact that as soon as they put Stephanie and Mick and Shane and Daniel Bryan ringside with not just... The title being on the line for those three, but for their shows, I thought there might be some interference by them.
But there wasn't.
And it just seemed pretty pointless that they just sit.
The one thing I did like, because they should have done this when they were actually doing the draft, was having each members of the locker rooms of SmackDown and Raw
watching
the match. That was good, because I think potentially they might have listened to the outcries of people going, where the fuck was that for the draft? They thought, well, we'll do it at the pay-per-view then.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I think that maybe that was them retconning.
Yeah.
But it was good. I'm glad they did it.
I mean,
made it feel like the competitors cared where that title went.
Yeah, I mean, the only other match I remember, Darren Young and Miz was a bit of a confusion by the end of it. It's like, so Bob Backlund gets slapped, Maurice falls down.
Out. Oh, Bob Backlund looks so stupid with his shirt stuck in his braces.
Yeah,
he's like a kid with a bib on.
I never really liked Bob.
You can even see him in his smirking, like, shit. Can't get it off.
It
was so cringeworthy. And I was kind of looking forward to that match after the build up with Darren Young and the Badass, and it just kind of thrown out.
I mean, it's revitalized his career a little bit. The same with the Rusev Ryder thing. For maybe 5% of the match, I thought maybe Ryder can do this. But
the fact that at any point you thought he could is a good thing. I think that I said this on my review, and I quite enjoyed the Rusev Zach match for one very good reason. We all knew that Rusev was going to retain. We knew that anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that it came away making Zach look a little bit stronger than he was before, he almost got himself out of the accolade, and he hit Rusev with quite a few hard hits a few times. And you think, he's really going for it.
Yeah.
He's making a lot more of an impression. I go, and that's good. So I think that was good storytelling. The fact that, we're not going to give him the belt yet because Rusev's still having this run and we don't want to take that away from him.
Yeah.
But we need to make Zach look stronger. And he did in that match. I think he did look better coming away from that match.
They brought out Mojo Rawley.
Yeah, that I thought was a bit weird.
Yeah, sorry, that's my phone.
Telephone.
It was only because he's Zack Ryder's tag partner in NXT, so it looks like they might be going the tag way with them. The way I've been thinking about how they could really revitalize the characters that they're struggling with. I mean, Titus needs to turn heel, I think. And I think he needs to be a bit of a monster.
Yeah, I could see that.
Apollo
gets a manager as well.
Yes. Apollo
doesn't have to be Paul Heyman, but just a manager of some kind, his mouthpiece.
Apollo Crews needs to smile less.
Yeah. He
needs to be serious on the whole thing. I wouldn't mind. I think the way with Heath Slater, they did it right on SmackDown, that he's going to be invading each show to kind of go, please, someone take me until something happens.
Well, on that, obviously, with Raw and SmackDown this week, Rhino.
Yes, and Shelton Benjamin's
coming back as well. And on Raw, we've got
Finn Balor.
Yeah, well, Balor, right, I found out as well when I mistakenly said that the other week. It's King Ross from
Culture
Wrestling.
Yeah.
He says Balor.
Well, he's wrong.
He says it all the time. Yeah. It's just like, and that's the reason. It keeps drilling into my head because every week I watch his What the Fuck moments and he keeps saying Balor.
Balor.
It's not Balor. It's Balor.
I think he...
But my brain's went Balor. I was like, fuck.
Shit. Damn it. But no, I mean, that kind of fastballs up. The only other thing about Grand I could think of was I really did enjoy the New Day Wyatt match.
Yes, so did I.
It
was told really well.
Yeah.
The Wyatts needed that win, deserved the win. They needed that. And having that thing with Xavier almost turning but not...
Yeah.
I enjoyed that. I think the story was told well, the match was good, they really enjoyed it, made Xavier look cool, it made the Wyatts look strong.
Yeah.
It was just really well told.
Did you see or did you hear Michael Cole's mess up? I think Strowman, he knocked either Xavier or Kofi away.
Flotting a swine.
He's like, he flotted in like a swine.
I know, he's like, what? Straight, I know, he's noticed it, me and Sarah went, what the fuck was that?
Himself.
And then we rewound it, it's like, flotting a swine? Are you fucking kidding me?
Swatting a fly, Michael.
You
swatting
fucking
a fly.
Idiot. He went quite quiet for the next couple of minutes after that. I bet he thought to himself,
and then on Raw, with Raw, it said Byron Sexton.
Yeah,
I saw that.
I was like, oh my God. Oh,
so Wood's fired.
If anybody doesn't know, we bantered about this many times and we just kept calling him Byron Sexton, Blackston Saxton and all this kind
of
stuff.
And then they do that.
And then they actually end up putting it on the table.
Yeah. Byron Sexton. Oh my God.
I thought
God.
It was brilliant.
I mean... That kind of... We missed what happened with the draft. I mean, I'm not going to be able to remember all the picks.
No.
I just know Seth is number one, Dean was number two. So, Dean's on SmackDown with the championship.
Yep.
Seth's on Raw. And, if you want to know, watch wrestling.
Because we're going to spoil it otherwise.
Well, yeah, but I think the NXT superstars I remember. Finn Balor, or Balor, I know you said it then.
See?
Finn Balor.
It's easy, rolls the tongue.
Balor. Finn Balor is on Raw. Which is excellent. I think he still maybe didn't need the announcement, but it's still making it work.
Yeah, they've kind of clawed it back a little bit better. But with what they did with it that night as well.
Yeah.
Just they had two fatal four ways. He won his respective. Reigns obviously won his respective. And then having him go over on Reigns.
Straight off the bat.
Straight off the bat. Literally, they're putting all their chips behind him. And it gives me hope that they go, he's going to beat Seth. I feel like they're actually pushing him for it. It's a new era where the face and heel thing doesn't matter half as much. It's kind of like, we're giving this person an opportunity. If they take that opportunity, we'll run with them as long as possible. And it's like, it doesn't... They're facing it. Like you think, like with SmackDown, they've got Ziggler versus Ambrose for SummerSlam now.
Yes.
They're both face. But it's kind of like, it doesn't matter, because we want to see that match. It's kind of like, it doesn't matter whether you're a good guy or a bad guy, let's just see the matches we want to see at the moment.
I think, hopefully it's getting into Vince's head. It's either Vince has let Shane and Stephanie do their own thing and they're nailing it at the minute, or Vince has finally got it in his head that these people want to see wrestling, and this, yes, the character does matter, but we need to actually listen to the crowd.
Yeah.
Not the boo reaction, not the, well, yes, the boo reaction and the cheer reaction, but at the
atmosphere,
the actual reaction.
Yeah.
So,
because like for instance, like with Zayn and Owens, yes, Owens is a fantastic heel. He's the best heel in the company. He's one of the best heels I've ever seen in my life. He's brilliant.
Yeah.
But when they're in the ring together, doesn't matter. So like, the fact is, we're just watching these two go at it like two fucking rabid dogs, and it's brilliant to watch. And at no point do you think, I hate Owens and I love Sammy. You're like, these guys are awesome, they're putting on an amazing match, and they get standing ovations. It's stuff like that makes you go, the face and heel things become a little bit less irrelevant. It's still fun to watch, and if people can nail those characters, great. But when it comes down to the wire and we're watching these matches, it's not about who's heel and who's face, it's about enjoying this sport of them wrestling and doing it well.
It's the way I've always boxed the bats, and I respect Cena. He was the hardest working man in the business. But if you the easiest way is the way with Roman now. You want to get him hate on him, you give him either a title or a title shot, the main title thing. I didn't mind at all Cena being in the US title thing.
No, I thought that was a good open challenge thing was a good idea.
The thing at the minute is, who can beat Brock Lesnar? Because at the minute, he's just a wrecking ball and no one can stop him. And it's sort of a similar way with Cena, but it's like, instead of like, who can beat Brock in a storyline thing, Cena's more political, like, who are they actually going to have go over by beating Cena cleanly? And the last person that did that was Kevin.
Yeah,
so I mean, and AJ needs to do it. I mean, he got his victory. He lost at Battleground. That was the other thing.
Yeah, he needs to win at SummerSlam if they're going against it.
Yeah, I'm excited for the SmackDown SummerSlam card.
Yeah, so am I. I mean, back to the Balor Reigns match. I mean, it was a good match. Really quite enjoyed it.
Yeah,
and it's kind of making me laugh now of how far down the card Reigns is going. He lost three times. You know, I mean, he lost to Rollins
at
Money in the Bank. He got pinned by Dean at Battleground, and then the very next night he got pinned by a debuting Balor.
He did win his Fatal 4-Way, though.
He won his Fatal 4-Way, but we knew that was going to happen anyway. I looked at that card and went, he's going to win it. Of course he's going to win it.
I think it's partially punishment because of his little...
I think so, that's what I think. But
suspension.
I don't want him in the main event at the moment. With now we've got Balor, I don't need him in the main event. Putting that back to mid-card for a minute... Let him build up naturally. I think as a heel, personally, we've all said we should be turning him heel, but I don't know if they're going to do that. Just put him back to mid-card and let him build up naturally over the next few months. Maybe he can come back at Mania, maybe at the following Mania. He's got plenty of years in him. He's only in his mid-30s. He's got plenty of time. You can build him up slowly and put him back to the point where people are actually wanting to cheer for him.
Yeah, I think the only way that's going to work now is if the Shield return.
I don't think should happen for at least another 2 years.
I agree. The thing, it would have been interesting to be in the arena or watch Raw live that night with Finn Roman, because it's like, right, if Roman wins, he's facing Seth at SummerSlam again, and it's what no one ever wants to see, even though it's a new championship. But at the time, it would have seemed like, oh, they're going to go for Roman. And it's the same side with Finn there going, oh, I really want to see Finn Seth. Roman's still in their bad books. Which way they're going to go with this. So it would have been a really exciting match to watch live and not knowing, and they've definitely made the right choice. Finn versus Seth is going to be amazing.
Because, now they've announced the new Universal title, which I don't know if I like the name. I'll see what the title looks like. Yeah. I'd like to see what it looks like. The only thing I'm a bit reserved about as far as this new title is concerned is does that cheapen SmackDown now? Because this is a bigger title than the WWE title. It's like, oh my god, Dean's kept the title on SmackDown. Then the very next day, it's like, oh, we've got a new title, and it's going to be better than the last one, which kind of makes SmackDown more of the underdog again. And I don't want that.
I don't think that will happen.
I hope not. I really hope not, because I...
Even when I heard it, I thought, I think we're not the only people here, the reaction of Universal title. So I think either way they're going to go... Because it still doesn't change the fact that when you really think about the history of the belt Dean's got... It is the union of the WWE Championship and the World Heavyweight Championship. They're just calling it the WWE Championship.
Oh, they keep saying back and forth, though. Some of them are saying WWE Championship and some of them are saying World Heavyweight Championship. If you notice,
yeah. Well, yeah.
Three or four of
them. It would have made more sense.
So make your mind up. Just say what it is and keep it at that. How hard is it?
It would have made more sense for Raw to bring the World Heavyweight title back out of retirement. Because they were both on par, really. But it was always like that. Like, a few years, like WrestleMania, it'd be like, the World Heavyweight Championship would be the last match on. Mm. And then it kind of switched a little bit, and the WWE Championship was the last match. And it would go like that. But, I don't know, hopefully the Universal title will give it credit to its brand and not steal the spotlight off
SmackDown.
Yeah,
that's what I'm hoping.
So
overall, I think that at the moment they are on the right track.
Yeah.
And I'm really looking forward to SummerSlam. We've got three great matches at the moment.
And we got a new women's champion.
Yes.
Sasha Banks.
Sasha Banks, fuck yeah. I was
Thank
like,
God.
I looked at it and I was like, Jesus, I thought they would leave that to SummerSlam.
SummerSlam, yeah.
I was happy.
It's bringing the unpredictability back.
Yeah.
Which is making it must-see TV, which is smart.
Which is good, because they need it for both. Now they're separate brands, they need to have it wanted to tune into both each week.
Yeah.
There's another quick thing as well, just before we move on. The line that Orton delivered.
Oh, well, at
Highlight.
Fandango.
No, not the Fandango one. The one towards Lesnar.
Oh, no.
No enhancement needed.
Oh,
As soon as he did it, but he said, Even Jericho Lee Puller went, I think you're going to pay for that one. I was like, yeah, I think he fucking is.
I did like that, but I liked the fact that, you know, Jericho was, like, ripping him, you know, and, like, why come back to come get your ass kicked by Brock Lesnar? Because he's going to kick your ass. He goes, well, I wanted to make impacts, you know, and to make impact, when you come back, you go after the biggest, baddest dog around, and that's Brock Lesnar in a minute. He goes, how would it look if I came back after 10 months and went to WrestleMania fight and lose to Fandango? Which he did in WrestleMania 29.
Yeah, I thought that was good as well. I was like,
bit of a burn!
bit of a burn.
But I don't know if I like this. I found it Orton funny, but I don't know if I like the character, so to speak.
He's always better heel than he is face. Totally agree. But at the moment, I don't need him to be a heel because he's been a heel for so long.
But
so I think when he comes back, I'm fine with him being face at the moment.
I
don't mind.
Lesnar's obviously going to be on Raw this Monday. So Orton's been very happy-go-lucky. He had a good match against The Miz on SmackDown.
Yes.
So there's no ring rust.
See, I'm kind of hoping once he's done with Lesnar, loses to Lesnar, which we know he will.
Maybe a title picture.
I think maybe Intercontinental title picture. I'd like to see Orton and Miz go against each other. I wouldn't mind with that. It would keep Orton relevant, but not to the point of pushing him into the title because he's needed.
Yeah, after August, everything's going to blow up because you've got two pay-per-views a month.
Yeah.
So I think what Orton needs to do, I say I liked his funny stuff, but the sadistic, just cold blue eyes, no smiling, just focused, is I think the Orton we need to see at the minute.
I like that. Prefer it. But at the moment, I don't mind.
No, at the minute, it's fine. But when Lesnar's there, I'm hoping to God Heyman's with him. So
I know. If he's not there, it's going to suck.
Orton to go in with that serious face, go, I may have been in a good mood the last week. I am in a good mood. I'm back in my zone. But don't for one minute think I don't take you seriously.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
you may
I'm
be
like
the
that.
Beast, but I'm the Viper.
Viperville as well. I thought it was a bit
Viperville.
Cheesy. But, yeah, it's we're living in this world where everything's hashtagged, so I think it's a way of getting more buys. It's like, oh, yeah, Suplex City versus Viperville. It's kind of like everything's a little fad type thing.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I understand.
I'd be fine with what I just said with the whole, you know, don't take you seriously in the Viper, Apex Predator, all that kind of stuff. Because, I mean, if they went with that and Heyman was there, it could be like, you may be the Apex Predator, but Brock is the Predator kind of thing. The only other character thing I'd like, he goes, let me introduce myself, I'm Randy Orton, Legend Killer. And if they bring that
back,
I'm going to kill the legend of Brock Lesnar. And even if you really want, during the build-up, goes, with his, if he has these things with Heyman, because they're both great in the mouthpiece, go, if you're not careful, I'm going to kill the legend of Paul Heyman. I go like, whoa, we're able to back off a little
bit.
Yeah,
about that.
But
yeah, I mean, overall, I'm looking forward to more.
I mean,
they're doing really well. For a change, we're actually sitting here looking optimistic for WWE.
I mean, just as a quick, almost do my what culture thing. Oh, by the way, my article got denied.
Yeah, they told me.
I was like, balls
denial!
Yeah, but we'll see about that. But again, I was trying to think of ways they should go, even though they are going in the right direction. And the way I'm thinking at the minute is, like, once Brock's done with Orton, what's next? And
now you'll go away until Mania, probably.
Well, what's I think now better with the brand split is that different people can focus on developing the characters better. And they did the right thing with Kane, that thing on SmackDown, where he wiped out both Sammy and Kevin. It's like, right, he ain't thinking about the demons back. So if there's months and months of Kane even beating nobodies, of just dominating everybody, and even at the next pay-per-view after SummerSlam, going against the likes of I don't know, not a bad superstar, but...
mediocre.
Yeah, even if it's Heath like invading him, I want a match, Kane comes out, wipes him out. A lot of him just wiping people out for the next couple of months. Again, in the next pay-per-view after that, someone a bit more up the card. Maybe a Jericho or something like that. Kane's wiped out Jericho. And then Lesnar returns for Survivor Series, and he needs an opponent. And if Kane's built up enough, Demon versus the Beast.
Yeah,
like, well, the Demon's Finn. But the Big Red Machine versus the Beast. And the storyline could be about The Undertaker. Okay, like... yeah, okay, you've beat my brother on numerous occasions. I think Lesnar's beat Kane once in his entire career.
Yeah, alright.
Because I'm bigger, I'm strong. I may not be my brother, but I'm bigger, I'm stronger, and believe me, I'm more deadlier than my brother can be. And it could work. And even if Brock won at Survivor Series, you've got to make it look like he nearly lost and not slow down Kane's momentum. And then, for the remainder of, hopefully, the year, Kane will be seen as a force to be reckoned with in the SmackDown locker room.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, we'll go with that.
Let's go.
So literally a couple of more things just before we get to questions.
Mm-hmm.
First one, Steven Spielberg announced about 3-4 weeks ago that he's not going to kill Indiana Jones because people were rumouring that he might.
No, it wouldn't.
So
work.
I'm glad that he just said, no, I'm not going to kill him. And so like, the Han Solo thing was a one-off. I'm not going to kill his character as well, so don't worry about
it. I don't think it would work anyway if they killed Indiana Jones.
No, not at all. And the next one was, have you seen who's been cast as Zordon for the Power Rangers reboot?
Yes!
It's fucking Bryan Cranston, man! This is just giving me so much more hope. I mean, did you see some of the pictures from Comic-Con of the helmets and the power coins?
I've seen the helmets, and I've seen what Rita looks like.
Have you seen the power coins?
No, I've seen
They're primitive as fuck. They look like fucking, like, crystal inside this, like, amber thing. It's, like, really primitive.
Right, cool.
And then, obviously, the helmets look kind of scaly and everything. So, obviously, this technology is so alien.
Yeah.
They're really hailing it. I think they're going to get a trailer within the next few weeks, I think.
I don't know. Obviously, we know that Zordon is the guy in the big tube.
Yeah, the head in the tube.
I don't know if I'll be laughing at the fact that Cranston's face is in a tube.
Depends how they do it. They could do a full body or something like that. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, if they made him... they could even put in the storyline that he's actually a walking man at first, and then... something happens where his spirit has to be put on his kind of tube. Because I remember the original movie, and it was okay. At the time, I thought it was great as a kid.
I still think it was great.
Yeah. Looking back on it, I was like, right, he's killed Zordon, and he's just this old grey man crippled in a bowl of crystal and stuff.
In a bag.
I always liked the fact that you probably don't remember the scene, but it just sticks out in my head all the time. After the attack, the Power Rangers lost their powers, but they go to the base, whatever. Sears attacked, and they're like, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god. And Alpha comes out of nowhere, like, Rangers. And they go, Alpha, are you alright? Yeah, I'll be fine. It's just like, you're a Ranger.
They've also confirmed that Alpha 5 is going to be in it as well, because we hadn't heard anything.
Yeah, it wouldn't have worked without
Alpha. The director said, he will be there.
Yeah.
Which is good.
What made that film for me originally was, even looking back at it, the guy who played Ivan Ooze was excellent. I thought he was funny.
Absolutely.
You could believe
really
in his evil,
guy,
but
really
he was almost Joker-esque with the whole thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, when he did that spell on the adults of...
where the fuck do they live?
Angel Grove, there you go. And he did that, and they were working for him under the spell and would literally listen to anything he'd say. So he goes, they built his machines and stuff. And he goes, you've all done very good jobs at making my creations for me. But frankly, I'm tired of your boring personalities and ugly faces. So can you please just go and walk to your doom? Goldar, have they got Goldar in it?
He hasn't said
that. Like, they need Goldar, and I think they should keep Lord Zedd for a sequel.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, and Green Ranger should be like an after credit scene for the sequel.
Yeah, and maybe the White Ranger if they want to continue. Yeah, further on. So.
Yeah, and the last one before we go into questions, obviously you're going to be annoyed.
I know what's happening now. Oh,
Pokemon Go, motherfucker! Pokemon Go is like this amazing thing, and it's just... I'm going to be reviewing it soon, so I'm going to do it with you. But you haven't got it yet because he has a Windows phone, so he can't have it.
I don't even know if I want it.
But, dude, honestly, I'm not being the fucking mouthpiece for it, but it's a lot of fun. I know it's a little fad and it will eventually die away, but I think it's great. I think it's a good little way to get communities together. I think it's fun to get you exercising. I think it's a cool little game to have a laugh with.
I'm not denying it's not a good idea.
I think the whole premise and the whole thing about it is good. Yeah, it has its flaws, but what fucking app doesn't?
The good ideas were, well, just the idea of it, yes. The fact that it's the original Pokemon, yes.
Yeah.
But it should be a kids thing.
It isn't. It's like, this is the thing. It's like, I've not seen any kids wandering around doing it. Everybody's been 18 and above. I've not seen any. I mean, at the end of the day, if you're 12, 13 years old, you shouldn't be wandering around by yourself anyway. It's your fucking parents' fault, not the apps. But most of the people I've seen doing it are our age, because Pokemon became such a big deal when we were kids. It hit hard when we were kids. We became obsessed with it, and it became a great thing, and I loved it. So having this kind of thing, you always say, I remember saying when I was a kid, I really hope I can do this in the real world one day. As a kid, you think of that. And this is as close as we can get to that. I think nostalgia sets in. You go, you know what, yeah, I'm going to give this a try. And then you get hooked by it. I think it is a lot of fun.
It might be, well, one of the things I'm thinking is, like, when winter hits, is it going to be as big, or people go, no, it's too cold to wander around?
I'm totally fine with wrapping up and going for a walk. Because I've got a feeling that, because they said to do with seasons, Pokemon can change where they'll be.
Well, yeah, that makes sense. I mean, if they really wanted to go, oh, we need people, it's not summer anymore.
We need some ice getting
Articuno out there.
Yeah.
People might be wandering around trying to find it. But I think it's because the two things I always wanted from the Pokemon stuff was bring back the original trading cards. Because the Cards Against Humanity thing took the world by storm a little bit.
Yeah, but it's kind of died off.
It has died off a bit, but it's still good. Mm. But I guarantee if this wasn't Pokemon Go now and they go, the original trading cards are back, I think a lot of us will be around here getting actually playing the game, going for it, maybe trading again, or the revamped version of the Game Boy games. Like,
well, they are
the console or what?
Yeah, they are revamping them. They're not revamping them, just bringing them back out for the console.
I've always wanted either a kind of console game where it's free roam or even the same as the Game Boy thing, but first person point of view. And you've got a storyline.
Like scoring for Pokemon.
Exactly.
Which I think they will do eventually. But one thing they have announced that they will be doing now, because the stocks have gone so far up for Nintendo with the release of Pokemon Go, that they're doing they have finally commissioned a live-action Pokemon film.
Yeah.
I'm intrigued. If they do it, cater to our nostalgia like they do with the Power Rangers movie, I think they can nail it. If they do it right.
Also, just to quickly go through over these, I've seen the Dragon Ball Z stuff. The 4D look of one of the characters, the blue, the white and purple dude. You watch Dragon Ball Z?
Yeah, I know. I don't know what you're on about though.
They released because they're doing a Dragon Ball Z movie again.
Are they?
Yeah, it's been news for ages, man.
I didn't know about this. I can't believe I didn't know about
this. Check it out, man.
I have not seen this.
Check it out. It's on YouTube. It's everywhere.
I didn't know they were doing it again. I thought the fucking first one failed so badly,
which is why they're redoing it. They're doing it properly this time.
See, I've always said if they're going to do it, they should be doing it like Man of Steel, that kind of thing. Because Goku is like Superman. As far as he comes from a different planet to destroy it, but ends up being the good guy for it, and then takes on all newcomers.
Well, who's the character? I think he's got a tail. He's all white. He's got like purple dots all
Freezer.
Around him. Yeah, him. They're showing like their
concept art.
No, they got the cinematic view of him. And everything. We'll look at it a bit. And I'm getting more excited for Suicide Squad. Basically,
I mean, I'll put the tickets. I can't wait.
I'm really gutted. I mean, Leicester. But
time to buy something else for your birthday.
Yeah, my mum said, "No, well, I can take you now. That'll be one of my birthday events for you." I was like, "All right, whatever." So, all right, let's do this.
Right. Questions for Josh. Then we gonna do the little do the jingle.
Yeah, I gotta remember how it goes. Count me in.
It's twice, and then da 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 da.
Yeah, right.
Good? Okay. Right. 1, 2, 3, 4. Questions. Questions. Questions for Josh.
That worked quite well.
I've got one from a friend and the rest from random people.
Okay. You didn't make them up, did you?
No, no,
yeah.
I don't do that.
I don't do that.
Do that at all. What are you talking about?
Oh, okay.
No idea what you're talking about. Okay, right, yeah, the first one was actually from Amy McElveen. She did it last time, but didn't get it in time.
No, I can't remember what she said.
It's just a simple, who is your favourite Catwoman and why? Shit character.
Right.
Well, not a shit character, but...
The only four that come to mind are the one from the original Adam West Batman thing,
yeah.
Where I was like, I don't know who she is, I'm not even going to reference her because I don't care. Halle Berry sucked.
Oh, God, yeah, let's
sucked, that.
Moving on.
So it's really between Anne Hathaway and Michelle Pfeiffer. And I'm going to go with Michelle Pfeiffer.
Yes, I would as well. It's close, because I think Anne Hathaway did a really good job.
She did okay, but I always thought, watching The Dark Knight Rises, when I really thought about it, her character was somewhat irrelevant. The only time it was relevant was where she lured Batman into the trap where Bane was there. And also, I couldn't really believe it. I mean, the only other one, the Michelle Pfeiffer one, I think I might have liked because of how dark and twisted she was. And you saw the downfall of why... She became...
Cared more.
Yeah, but also, it didn't go to the fact that... she in the film, the Batman Returns film, she fell in love with Bruce more than she did Batman, where it was the other way round.
Yeah.
And the cat burglar part wasn't really touched on that much. So, really, even though I'm going with Michelle Pfeiffer, the Selina from the Gotham series, I think, is doing very well.
Yeah, she's one of the characters I quite enjoyed.
Yeah, she got that cat look as well, which is really weird. So yeah, but still, Michelle Pfeiffer, yeah.
All right, second one, a guy from Matthew Peters.
Mm-hmm.
If you could step into any universe, what would it be? E.g. Star Wars, Star Trek, Marvel, DC, Harry Potter, so on and so forth.
Right, is it really going to be one of them?
Any universe you want. Games, video, TV, I'd say just anything.
Anything?
Yeah, any universe that you want to step into, what would it be?
Right. It'd be very easy for me to say a universe I've kind of really stepped in, which is the rock and metal universe when I'm drumming with you guys and stuff. But because I've already done that, but no, obviously not hit.
He's retired. He's retired at the rock
edge.
He's reached the peak. And he doesn't want to go any further.
I haven't hit download yet. I've sold my kit, for God's sake. So, but WWE Universe.
Really?
I would. Yeah. I remember telling you the whole I applied for a job. Anything.
That's fair enough.
To do with, obviously, the dream would be the ultimate dream that people don't actually fall asleep and dream about is walking down that aisle at WrestleMania and walking out with the championship. Even though, personally, in my head, it'd either be fighting a best friend or my brother at that kind of grand stage. But, yeah, if we're talking fantasy, I'd probably have to go Star Wars. Though.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I want a lightsaber.
Yeah. We all want a lightsaber. Yeah. UKAssassin_91@gmail.com says, are you looking forward to the Power Rangers reboot? What do you want to see? We've kind of already touched on this.
Yeah,
really.
I
just
am.
Just making quick of what you want to see, really.
Yeah, I am, but I'm not, like, super stoked about it just yet.
I see a trailer.
Yeah, I saw the fan-made one. I was very happy with that, but I don't think that's what we're going to get.
It's not going to be as gritty.
What I'm looking forward to is what they do with the Zords.
Yes, I agree.
And I think it might be a sequel kind of thing. Instead of the Megazord itself, I'd want to see the Dragon Zord.
Yeah, but it means seeing the Green Ranger... And I want to see the Green Ranger.
Yeah, if we're talking...
But I feel like that should, like I said, be an after-credit scene where you see the green power coin or you see the helmet or something like that and you go, holy shit, the next one's going to have the Green Ranger. Just to make you come back.
As for an original thing then, just the Zords. Because obviously, it'll probably be almost played out like a typical Power Rangers episode was in the 90s. Rita will create a monster, it'll be kicking their ass at first, they'll have like... a team thing where we do it this way, then she makes it big and then the Zords come.
Yeah.
So it's all about the Zords.
Absolutely. Yeah. All right, last one. I'm hoping this has got a funny answer. Have you ever literally pissed yourself laughing? If so, what was it about?
I think I have.
I honestly thought you'd say no.
No, I think I have, but... Probably...
You laughed so hard you pissed yourself.
Yeah, but I think... I do remember. It was at school, and for the life of me, I can't remember. But you know when you're in that... people listening to this won't get it, but how you guys were the night before the wedding in the room.
Oh, you've been laughing so hard.
Just laughing all the time.
Exhausted by laughing
About nothing, and the fact that you keep laughing is what's funnier, so it's never ended. Something like that, and I was on a table with three guys I didn't really hang around with that often, but laughing really hard, that bit where your stomach's hurting.
Your brain's hurting, lack of oxygen.
And your face hurts, and I'm trying to calm down, but at the same time, I think, I need to fart as well. And I don't want to embarrass myself by farting in front of everybody. So I'm thinking, during the laughter, I'll just let it slip out. And it was just at that point where the laughter went, and the guy next to me, and they all laughed again, and a little bit of wee came out.
But so you didn't actually fully piss yourself.
No, I didn't like piss down my leg. Like, it was just when you feel even your dick's laughing.
God! I remember someone at high school once. They did massive piggyback wars, and this girl pissed herself because she was on piggybacking on someone having piggyback wars as you do as a kid.
Yeah,
and they were laughing so hard that the woman on the back pissed all over the other person.
Oh no!
I remember it happening. I was just sitting there watching. I was like, oh my god, I can't believe I'm just seeing this.
The only two that I usually cry when I laugh, and the only two times recently I can think of is a joke my brother told me that I think I told you at the Indian, I did tell you the Indian about Peter Pan, I don't think I can tell it on here.
No.
If you want to check out Frankie Boyle.
Put yourself down in the comments if you want to hear it, and then we'll do it next time.
And usually a lot of what happened on the Ricky Gervais Show podcast thing, especially the meatballs thing.
Square tins.
Yeah, oh man. I mean, my brother told me about that. I said he was rolling around the bed. He told me that. Or it was the build-up to it, and then the stupidity of it just floored me. I was on my knees cringing.
That would be interesting for meatballs.
It's not even something Carl said, either. But I think it was Ricky's reaction. Asthmatic kid trying to inhale. Like, and then falling off the floor, off the chair, and Stephen having to explain what happened. Like, Ricky's just fell off the chair.
You can hear him in the back, oh god!
Yeah, fucking hell! And then as they put up the song, you hear the back going, oh!
That was good. It was really good. That's the end of podcast 7, isn't it?
Yeah, it only took 70 minutes or so.
So, yeah, the next one should be coming a few days after SummerSlam.
About 4 weeks.
So, like, subscribe, check all the other podcasts out, check all my other reviews out. I will be doing a review of Pokemon Go soon of what I thought of it, although...
Typical.
Yeah, well...
I won't be part of that.
No, he definitely will not be part of that. I'll be doing Suicide Squad as well once I've seen it next week, so keep a lookout for them.
We'll probably talk about that as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, yes, like, subscribe, and we'll see you next time.
Ta-ra!
Bye!